May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to all of you who have joined me here this morning for worship. It's great to have you join with me, and to those who will join us later on in watching our online service, again, it's good to have them join at any point in the day. But remember, this is a place of grace and not perfection, and everyone is welcome. So as we begin our worship this morning, as we journey through the season of Pentecost, let's still our hearts and minds as we pray together. Let's pray. Lord, in this shared time, we offer ourselves to each other. We offer our understandings and insights, not to dominate or overthrow one another, but that we ourselves might be challenged and changed. We offer our emotions and experiences not in self-indulgence, but that through honesty and openness, we may find and give encouragement and comfort. And as we celebrate and offer our common humanity, the very flesh and fabric of our lives, may you, the incarnate one, be once again embodied here in our individuality and our community. Amen. So let us begin our worship this morning by singing our opening hymn, hymn number 212, Morning Has Broken, and if you're able, we'll stand to sing. Let us speak with God in prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we are here in the name of Christ. We come to bow our heads, to lift up our hearts, and to offer you our praise. We come this day to confess Jesus Christ as Lord, to enthrone him in our lives and to offer him our commitment. And so we come as we are to seek his will, to hear his word, and receive his blessing. Loving God, we praise you for all you have done through Christ. His revelation of your great love and glory. His obedience and faithfulness even to the cross itself. His victory over death and exaltation to your side. His promise to come again as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Help us this day as we who gather worship to recognize Christ is here among us. Help us to glimpse your glory through him, to hear his voice through this service, to feel his love through our fellowship, and to see more clearly where we can serve him in the needs of our world. Help us to bear his name faithfully and live each day to the glory of his name. So, loving God, hear our prayers. Amen. We're going to sing again. This time we're going to sing hymn number 252, As the Fire is Meant for Burning. And we haven't sang this in a while, so Christine's going to play it through once for us. And then once she's done that, we'll stand to sing. Thank you, Christine. places. Our reading this morning is taken from the book of Galatians, Galatians chapter 5, beginning at verse 13. So let's listen to the words of God. Paul writes, "As for you, my brothers and sisters, you were called to be free. But do not let this freedom become an excuse for letting your physical desires control you. Instead, let love make you serve one another. For the whole law is summed up in one commandment. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. But if you act like wild animals, hurting and harming each other, then watch out, or you will completely destroy one another. What I say is this: let the Spirit direct your life, and you will not satisfy the desires of human nature. For what our human nature wants is opposed to what the Spirit wants, and what the Spirit wants is opposed to what our human nature wants. These two are enemies, and this means that you cannot do what you want to do. If the Spirit leads you, then you are not subject to the law. But the Spirit produces love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, and self-control. There is no law against such things as these. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have put to death their human nature with all its passions and desires. The Spirit has given us life. He must also control our lives. We must not be proud or irritate one another or be jealous of one another." The words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us join together in prayer again. And as we do this morning during our prayer and during the time of silence, Christine is going to play a piece of music for us. So let's pray together. O living Christ and ever-present Saviour, draw very near to us and to those who are struggling at this time. Draw near to those who are sick, the sorrowful, the suffering, and to those who have asked for our prayers. Though absent from us, we know their names are written on your heart, and bear every weakness known to you. Grant them, even as we pray, rest and relief, bodily comfort and spiritual consolation. And we bring them to you in faith, and we leave them with you in entire dependence on your unchanging love. Enfold them in your strength and bring them, even through sorrow, to a vision of your eternal peace. And thine shall be the glory, world without end. Almighty God, who loves all and forgets none, we bring to you now our prayers for all of your children, of all of your creation. And we remember before you all who have been bereaved of family and friends, all who are troubled by the suffering of those they love, all who are met with earthly loss, that in the dark and cloudy day they may find assurance and peace in you. We pray for all who are burdened by grief, that they may be raised to know the secret and solidarity of the cross. For all who are lonely and sad in the midst of others' joy, may they know God as their friend and comforter. Remember, O Lord, the aged and infirm, those who feel that their life work is done, and all who are passing through the valley of shadows, that they might find that Christ, the risen from the dead, is with them, and that there is light at evening time. We give thanks for the tireless carers, except they aren't tireless anything but, and yet they have kept going at great cost to themselves, saving lives. And as we emerge from these challenging last few years, recognising what we have gained and lost during our time of separation, we bow our hearts and heads with sadness for the many loved ones who have died from or because of COVID-19 and during that time when we could not gather to support each other. May our tears fall with the memories of absence, of too many final moments spent apart. God of all comfort, bring peace. And draw close even when we have wandered far. Draw close even when our hearts are heavy, when we struggle to believe you care or that you are even there at all. So Lord, in this moment of silence, hear our prayers. Hear us, Lord. Accept our prayers and be merciful to us. And continue to be our help throughout our days. So, Lord, hear our prayers. Amen. Thank you, Christine. We're going to sing again this night. I want to introduce a new hymn to you. It's called Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God. And the words and the music will be up on the screen because it's the first time we're going to sing this. We're going to remain seated and you can follow the words on the screen, and I do hope you enjoy this hymn. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight. For you are our strength and a redeemer. Amen. When I was a child, not that long ago, We would often visit an aunt who stayed in Pollock Shaws. And on her kitchen table, which was in the recess of her room, there would be this beautiful glass-cut fruit bowl, which was filled with brightly coloured fruit. And I would often wonder what some of these fruits would be like to taste. However, the rule was when visiting my aunt was not to touch. Each week we would visit, and each week I would have my eyes on that bowl of fruit, but remembering not to touch, to only look with my eyes. However, one day I resisted. I couldn't resist the fact when my aunt stepped out of the room for a moment, I seized the opportunity. I disobeyed her rule of not touching and went to the fruit bowl and picked up this beautiful, juicy piece of fruit, which was a peach. However, you can imagine the shock and disappointment I felt afterwards, after tasting that peach. Not because I disobeyed her rules, it was the fact that the fruit which was sitting in this beautiful cut glass bowl was plastic. All those times I sat admiring these colourful pieces of fruit were actually plastic, artificial. Every week she would dust and polish that bowl to give the impression to anyone who visited that she had a beautiful fruit bowl, but she couldn't eat. Now you may be wondering where I am going with this story, so let me explain this to you. Over the summer, I thought I would move away from the standard lectionary which we follow and preach on a short series based around the fruits of the Spirit, which are spoken and referred to in the book of Galatians. So first things first, and I won't put you on the spot, there are 9 fruits of the Spirit: love, faithfulness, joy, patience, gentleness, peace, kindness, self-control, and goodness. And if you get any sense, you can read them off the screen behind me. There we are. And over the coming weeks, I'm going to delve deeper into these fruits of the Spirit and how we as Christians need to recognise what characteristics shape who we are, our strengths and our weaknesses, and how this will change our Christian life. So when we read the scriptures, which I hope you all do on a daily basis, you will see different meanings and interpretations of, first of all, the word fruit. In the Old Testament, the term fruit, which used in the literal sense, is the edible product. But when you look at Deuteronomy, it says the fruit of your ground. But from a metaphorical stance, however, the word fruit can have several meanings. It can relate to offspring, for example, the fruit of your womb, or it can relate to the result of an action, for example, a reward or salary. And in the New Testament, and in particular the Gospel of Matthew, the word fruit appears around 54 times. Again, it means a product of the earth. But what you'll notice when Jesus speaks of the fruit, he is referring to the action or a character trait. In Galatians, prior to this reading, you will read a man reaps from what he sows, or with regards to the Holy Spirit, it is the presence and the powerful action of the Holy Spirit, which grafts us into Jesus, the true vine. The fruit of the Spirit attaches us to Jesus. As he says in John 15, verse 5, if you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And one other difference to remember is when we speak about the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit, try not to confuse them. When we speak about the gifts of the Spirit, we are referring to how we serve each other, whereas the fruits of the Spirit is to change us internally and to enable the transformation of our character. And although the gifts of the Spirit and the fruits of the Spirit are linked to one another, we need both in our Christian life. They are independent, complementary, and inseparable. But the second point I want to make today is we need to understand the context of the letters to the Galatians and why the Apostle Paul writes these letters and why he emphasises the fruits of the Spirit. Some theologians refer to Galatians as the Magna Carta of evangelical Christianity. It is Paul's great declaration of religious freedom, a freedom that involves independence from humanity and more dependence upon God. And Paul writes these letters some 20 years after the crucifixion. And his letters are written from a viewpoint of one who is still racked with self-contradiction, whose life is being pulled in two conflicting directions. Remember, before his experience on the road to Damascus, Saul, as he was known as, was once a Roman citizen, and now he is Paul, the Jewish Christian, who has become a missionary for the faith. So you can understand the turmoil he must be facing, and he has his self-doubt, for he was one of who was formerly persecuting the young Christian and who is now proclaiming the faith. And these letters that Paul writes are highly personal, for he devotes time writing about his story of faith, the spiritual pilgrimage that he was on, and his swirls in controversy. But Paul never wrote letters without good reason. So it's assumed that his letters were in reply to questions received from churches or to describe news that he has heard about churches. So writing to the church in Galatia, Paul's message was to assure these new Galatian believers that by putting their faith in the Messiah, Jesus, they had in fact become part of God's people. They too were children of Abraham. Because they were the Gentiles, they didn't have to become part of the Jewish tradition, but they became children of God. These Galatians had been adopted into God's family by God's grace and through faith in Jesus the Messiah. And though they were Gentiles, they were included among the spiritual seed of Abraham. And that is why Paul tells them, if you are in Christ, then you are in Abraham, and God's promises are for you also. But Paul at that time in his letter were also challenging those within the Jewish community who did not think it was enough for these Gentiles to put their faith in Jesus. They believed that if these Gentiles wanted the blessings of the promises that God had made to Abraham, then they must join the people of Abraham by becoming Jewish proselytes. Gentiles who converted to the Jewish faith by being circumcised and observing the law of Moses. So Paul wrote this letter to the Gentiles of Galatia who were vulnerable in their faith and were finding the going difficult, especially within the Jewish community. And he wrote his letter in response to offset the claims and answer their accusations, and to offer support and guidance to those who were new to the faith, to reassure them that the gospel of Jesus had set them free. And since they trusted in the Messiah, it didn't matter if they were circumcised or not. What mattered was their faith was real and was proving its reality by their love. So that, my friends, is the background to what was happening when Paul wrote his letter to the Galatians. And you may well be sitting here thinking, well, that's all very good, Fiona, but why the fruits of the Spirit and Paul's letter? Why is it important today? It's this. These qualities, these fruits of the Spirit that Paul speaks about, are about our own Christian character. It is who we are We may be patient or quick-tempered. And to be honest, so much of the emphasis upon Christian character can feel greatly undervalued today in so much church life and activity. As one writer noted, we'd rather work out the best techniques, formulate successful strategies, and celebrate or even worse, criticise performance. We look on the outside and assess people by how they are doing, and pay much less action to what kinds of character they have become or are becoming. But so when we look at the qualities in Paul's list of the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, they do not focus on the kind of performance we can achieve, but more importantly, what kind of person we are. So my brothers and sisters in Christ, the Spirit of God, which is the Spirit of Christ, will make the qualities of the life of Christ grow in a person's life, so that they and we become more and more like Christ himself, which is God's desire for all his children. And as the great theologian John Stott would say in his daily prayers, Heavenly Father, I pray that this day I may live in your presence and please you more and more. Jesus, I pray that this day I may take up my cross and follow you. Holy Spirit, I pray that this day you will fill me with yourself and cause your fruit to ripen in my love. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. When you think about it, fruit takes time to grow. Character takes time. It takes a lifetime. So over the coming weeks, we're going to take the time to study the fruits of the Spirit, the fruit in the orchard of God's Spirit. And we're going to take the time to let these fruits revolve and evolve in our own lives, to shape our Christian character through all the time God's give us. So we're going to look at joy, peace, love, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And we'll recognise our own strengths and our own weaknesses, and how we can recognise who we are as children of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forevermore. Amen. We're going to make our offering now, and as the offering is brought forward, remain seated and we'll sing Praise God from whom all blessings flow. So let's make our offering. Loving God, we bring you our gifts to you, knowing that you can change the world through the offerings we make. Enable and equip each of us to be part of that change, to break down barriers, to open the doors to those who are deemed outsiders, and to bring the gospel of truth and love alive to those who will listen. Living Lord, give us grace to offer the whole of our lives that you might make a difference in this world through us. So, living Lord, hear our prayers. Amen. I have a few intimations to make. The community cafe will be open this Wednesday and Friday, and all are welcome. Next Sunday, we should be celebrating the sacrament of baptism, and we're looking forward to that. There is our annual stated meeting. It's going to take place directly after the church service this morning, so if you're able to stay behind and listen to what we've got to share with you, we would really appreciate that. And it won't be too long, so there's no tea and coffee today after our service. It's because of our annual stated meeting. There will be copies of accounts, and if you give us 5 or 10 minutes just to set up the front, we'd really appreciate that. And the last intimation is from Connie and Liz Little, who are overseeing our Muddy Church Garden. And the email goes like this: Connie and Liz are going batty again. Love it, I love it. If you'd like to do some bat detecting, they're inviting all of you to come to the church garden at the police station side at 10 o'clock in the evening. Is that correct, Connie? Yes, yes. Liz, sorry, I never saw you there. On Wednesday, the 6th of July. So if you need any more information about looking after the bats and counting them, speak to Liz or Connie at the back. And if you've not seen the Muddy Church Garden, you should go have a wee look at it. It's coming on really well, and they've been working hard in it as well. And I think that's all the intimations I've got this morning. Thank you again for joining with me for worship today, and also to those who will be joining us later on once the service is uploaded onto our vlog. So on that note, we're going to sing our closing hymn, hymn number 166, Lord of All Hopefulness. So now go in peace, and may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you, those whom you love and those whom you struggle to love, now and forevermore.